There's two handouts coming around, but I'll tell you the details. So the title is Pep Talks for Catechists. And even though I know what a pep talk is, when I was getting ready for this, I decided to look up the definition. And one definition that I found said, a pep talk is a usually brief, intense, and emotional talk designed to influence or encourage an audience. This is usually a 5 to 10 minute speech given by your supervisor at work, so as to make you work twice as hard for the same amount of money. So I thought this sort of applies to teachers. So, first of all, let's look at a couple of famous pep talks. They're not pep talks for Catechists, but just to get us in the mood there. And then, would you share with one other person your answer to So one of them that you thought about, and we'll just take about 2 minutes for this, so each of you get 1 minute to share your answer.
Knowledge. And we're called to do that, but we're also called to to do much, much, much more than theirs. If the main goal of catechesis is to lead people to intimacy with Jesus, and that's what several of our catechetical documents remind us, that that's our main purpose, that's our main goal. If that's the goal, not just handing out information about Jesus, about Scripture, about God, about prayer, about church, if our main goal is to lead people to intimacy with Jesus, then our goal is to be a witness. Our goal is to be a companion traveler on this journey of faith, on this journey of relationship. Pope Paul VI wrote in one of his documents, "Modern men and women listen more willingly to witnesses than to teachers. And if they do listen to teachers, it is because they, teachers, are witnesses." And so we as catechists, no matter whether we're catechists of kindergartners, young children, older children, youth, or adults, we're called to be many things. We're called to be imaginative facilitators. We're called to be imaginers of the gospel. Which one of the things that means is that we have to use all the methods that are available to us. Because, especially if we're working with children and youth, we're educating generation.com, not Generation X. And so the gospel is too rich. Our relationship with Jesus is too rich to be contained just within one paradigm. We're called to be faithful midwives, mid-husbands, giving birth. We're called to be compassionate guides. We're called to be dynamic animators. You know, St. Ignatius, they say, was not converted by reading Scripture. He read popular accounts of the lives of St. Francis and St. Dominic. And they were probably filled with exaggerations and inaccuracies. But what they did was they stirred Ignatius's imagination and refocused his life. So we're not talking about just reading a book. We're not talking just about teaching. We're talking about learning. We're talking about bringing the faith alive, animating the faith. So it's not just on the pages. And our leaders, are active participants. They're eager to be involved. We're also called to be prayerful catalysts, to call forth something new. We're called to be God's gardeners. God has planted a seed. It doesn't come from us. One of the things that bothers me is sometimes we talk and say that our role, and I'm not just meaning Catholics, a lot of people in the church, that our role is to bring God to people. It's not. God is already there. Our role is to set the atmosphere, the environment, to help people, children, adults, discover the God that's already in their life. So we're called to be creative artisans. Think about artists. Artists break out of traditional ways of seeing the world. So we are artisans of our faith in today's culture. On the 30th anniversary of Vatican II, Cardinal Koenig from Vienna, who was retired at the time, wrote, he said, "More than earlier centuries, all Christians today must rely on images in our talk about God. do lots more than just words. We're also as campus pilgrims on the journey. We're with them. And children, adults pick that up. If we separate ourselves from them, as though we have all the answers, it's not passing on the faith, because we're all pilgrims on the journey. And we're also gospel-defined campus. It's the gospel who calls us to be who we're called to be. So in summary, a way of looking at who we are, which I think is the foundational pep talk, is to take time to think about who we are. Could be combined or could be explained in these four roles of who we are as a campus. That we're companions on the journey. We teach the beliefs and traditions of our faith in ways that stimulate reflection and conversation. And our words and actions not only teach the faith, but who we are, we model for our members. Being a companion on the journey. We journey as campus together. That's why I think a day like today is so tremendous, because you realize you're not doing this alone. And just think that there's lots more people like you all across this archdiocese, all across this country, all across our world. So we're companions with other campuses, even though we might never see them. And then we're companions with the families that we minister to. Sometimes people who are campuses who are ministering to children think that that's their only role, but it's not. We might have before us every day or every week a group of children or a group of youth, but we're ministering to their whole family. Everything that we do touches not just those children, but the whole family. And I think we need more and more ways, too, to be companions, to look at ways to be companions to the families. Another one of our goals, reminding us who we are, which will get us through some of the hard times, is that we're storytellers. Our role is to share the beliefs and traditions in a way that touches not just the head, but also the heart and the hands. That we don't just have the facts. Stories help us not just to have the facts, but also to enter into relationship with God, and then to do something about it with our hands, to make a difference in our world. Jesus is the model for that. We just have to look at Scripture and see that Jesus often used stories and parables to tell his message. So we're called to teach as Jesus did, using stories in our tradition, in Scripture, stories of the saints, but also the stories of our own lives that tell us, that share with others how we've encountered God has meant to us. And a third role, which summarizes lots of the things we were talking about, is that we're called to be leaders of prayer. Our ministry is rooted in a deep relationship with God. So both personal prayer and liturgical prayer with the community assist us in growing in that relationship. And as a campus, there's many ways to pray with our learners, and that's our call. One of the things that really struck me years ago, how many people are familiar with the Myers-Briggs type indicator? So it tells us a lot about our personality, and there's been a lot of research done with Myers-Briggs to show that different personalities like to pray in different ways. And years ago, I was at a week-long retreat workshop on that, on images of God through the Myers-Briggs, our spirituality through Myers-Briggs and ways to pray. When I got there, another sister in my community was there. In fact, she was a friend of mine, much older than I am, and she's now deceased. But I didn't know she was coming. But anyway, about halfway through the workshop, she said to me, "Janet, this has been the most freeing thing in my life." And I said, "What do you mean?" And she said, "Well, for 40 years, I thought that I was a bad woman because I didn't like the way they prayed. I just couldn't, it didn't interest me. I didn't like to pray." She said, "Now, since the Second Vatican Council, because there's lots more kinds of opportunities and ways to pray open to us, there's lots of ways that I like to pray. They just weren't the structured ways that we prayed when I first entered the community." And when she said that, it dawned on me again that we are very fortunate because we have, in our tradition, many activities, many ways of praying. But every time we meet with the children or the youth or the adults, we pray in exactly the same way. It could be an excellent way to pray, and it might be the way that we like to pray. But there could easily be a third of that group, a fourth, a half of that group, that type of prayer doesn't appeal to them. And so I think our call, which is a challenge, is to be sure that we're sharing with them different forms of prayer within our tradition. It takes more planning, but we have a multitude, a treasure of prayer forms. And so the fourth goal of us as catechists, which remind us of who we are, which will get us through some of the hard times, is that we're also witnesses for justice. The National Directory for Catechesis reminds us, it says, "Our society needs the witness of Christians who take the social demands of the gospel seriously and who actively practice the virtue of social justice." So if we're to lead others too in serving, we have to be witnesses ourselves in that. Or to put all this in another way, the ABCs of what a catechist is. A catechist is an ambassador, an advocate. A catechist is a bridge builder. A catechist is a community builder, a confidant. A catechist is a discussion leader, an encourager, a friend. A catechist is a guide, a historian, an innovator, a justice seeker, a sharer of knowledge, a knowledge sharer. A catechist is a listener and a lover of all others, of all God's children. A mentor, a missionary, a nurturer, an organizer, an opportunity spotter, sometimes a public speaker, often a problem solver, a questioner, a reassuring presence. A catechist is a spokesperson, a spiritual director, teacher, a unifier, a visionary, a wizard. A catechist is extraordinary, a youth advocate, a zeal stoker, and also, at times, we feel like we're zookeepers. So, before we look at some specific pep talks for some specific reasons, I'd like to share a song with you, which is a reminder, I think, of who we are.
Thank you.
that might be in the Pep Talk. We're going to look at some others in a few minutes. But one possible one that maybe you've said yourself is, this isn't working. And it seems too much like school. And if you've ever said that, or your learners have ever said that, you're right. Because what we do is not school. Just as I said a minute ago, who we are is different from being a teacher. It's different from schooling. So I'd like to suggest, as a pep talk, two things that we might do. One is to watch our language, and second is to watch how we do things and what we do. So first of all, what do I mean when I say to watch our language? I would like to suggest, and I'm not the only one that says this, there's other people who are experts in this that say this, that we should look at avoiding all school language. It's easy in faith formation to talk about classes, classrooms, students, teachers, and homework. And yet catechesis is much more than an educational enterprise. And it's going to be a long time before we can change that mindset for people. It takes time. A friend of mine, and this was years ago, but she was in a parish and they didn't want to use the title CCD. And so they called it PSR, Parish School of Religion. And one day she was with her family and their five-year-old said, I know what PSR means. And Marianne said, oh, you do? What does it mean? And the little boy said, it means CCD. So it takes a long time to change mindsets and to change language. But can we begin the process of helping people to see that faith formation is very different than schooling by changing the paradigm shift by using different language? Catechist says something different than teacher. A catechist is one who echoes God, who echoes the good news. Faith formation sessions or gatherings don't sound as schoolish as classes. And the words children, youth, youngsters, young people encompass more of the whole person than just their role as student. Likewise, it's a wonderful practice to suggest home activities following each catechetical session. But I would invite us not to call them homework. Homework has, for many, has a very negative, have-to connotation. So, instead of homework, can it be home reflection time, family activities, or a myriad of other enticing names that you could come up with that hopefully will remove this activity from the school model and something that I have to do and that I'm going to be checked on. And then secondly, how we do things and what we do influences for ourselves and for our learners how things are working for them, and especially trying to make it different for school. So to give you some insights on this, that's one of the words of the actual learners. When I was in parish a couple of years, we did evaluations at the end of the year. But the part that we did with the children, we asked them some questions. And we felt we would get out how well we were doing by what they said. And so here's what some fifth graders said when we used these questions. We asked them, if you were the catechist for a day, what would you do? And they said, play religious themes, make the kids act up the lesson, talk about your day and what Christ had to do with your day. They're talking to the candidates. Doing stuff not so much in the books, but fun stuff that helps you learn about God. Go on field trips to nursing homes, hospitals, and homeless shelters. It would depend on the topic, but projects are fun and still teach you well, like skits, activities, and teamwork. And then another question we asked them was, if you were the catechist for a day, what wouldn't you do? And some of the things they said were, make them do worksheets, make them do written work, wouldn't read from the book, sit there and make them be quiet all hour, have them sit at desks or use books. I wouldn't always stick straight to the book and be boring, because the kids wouldn't learn as much. Not be boring and no lectures. So, the beginning feeling from the candidates that we just used was, this doesn't seem to be working. And sometimes it seems too much like school. And so, when we listened to the words, the feelings of the learners, none of them were saying they didn't want to learn about God, they didn't want to learn about their faith, but that there were ways to do that. So let's look at some other ideas, some other situations where we might need a pep talk. So do you want to take your other handout? And what I'm going to ask you to do is to get into groups of two. A couple groups might be three, but get with one other person. And we're going to ask each little group to look at one of the situations there and talk together about what would you say. If a person said this to you, if a candidate said this to you, what would be your advice? So I'm going to give you a minute to look at them with your partner and decide which one you want to do. And then we'll assign them so people are doing different ones. Okay, got it. Do you have one? 5 or 11? don't, okay. Do you know which one you want?
No.
5 or 11 is 11?
5 or 11.
11, they got 11, you got 5. Okay? So talk together for a few minutes. What would you say to somebody who said this to you?
Thank you.
Okay, can I merge that together? Okay, is there a group that would like to tell us your pep talk? What would you say? Okay, so the first one. If everybody who said, but I don't know enough, wasn't a catechist, none of us would be catechists.
I was going to say, doesn't everybody say that to start with?
Right, exactly.
That's exactly what I'm saying.
Yes.
I'm still learning.
And I'm sure you found, and I remember one catechist that I worked with specifically, at the end of the first year, she, okay, beautiful. No, but what she said was, and she said, I don't know if the kids heard anything, but I can't tell you how much I've grown this year in my faith. You know, and that is the reality, right? You learn best what you have to teach. Challenge, though, especially working with younger people, is sometimes you don't know when they get it. You know, and with other subjects, if you were a teacher and were teaching math or social studies, you could test to know if they got what you were teaching. And now we can test. We want you to figure out knowledge if they're retaining and all the facts of what we taught, and that's important. That's the essence of what we're doing. And so we don't always know until sometimes years later, they'll say something, or somebody in the family will say something. But that's the challenge sometimes, and that's the discouragement sometimes. Like, you know, I don't know if this is all worthwhile, because I don't know how it's affecting them. But when you do know how it's affecting them, it is, you're right, there's no substitute. Joy, and to know that if you walked with them in that journey, you didn't do it for them, whether no matter what age they are, but you walked with them in that journey. Right, sure does. Sure does. That's right. Good, thank you. Is there anybody else want to comment on number one? Did you think of something else? As you were listening, a reason you would share with somebody why they should consider being a campus? Pays well. That's true. Good one. Okay, how about another one? Somebody else want to share one of yours?
We have number 10.
Okay.
I signed up with meeting some other little people. So I asked we have to make it fun, but we also have to engage in the dialogue. So we, rather than read things, we get in and we make it fun in a way that they see what it's over. All right, they didn't know what the problem was. Get in and kind of explain it out, and we have to kind of guide the direction we want them to go and what we want to learn. And that way they can respond to their own book. And so I know the topic, you know, when we are dealing with the youngsters in on the age that they're talking to. So you got to get them, and then you got to know what their interests are. You know, if they're interested in certain games, I don't know what Pokemon really is, or maybe that's something that they might be related to that related story. You have to make something out to stretch the truth, exaggerate what happens to you, or get them to talk about things.
Excellent, great ideas. When you said too, like use what's of interest to them. Just during lunch, Joyce from Transfiguration was saying she created a Pokemon Saints. They're going to do it tomorrow, so, and I don't understand how it's working, but it's using that thing, but putting it to work for in our setting. So it's you're right. Especially today, it's what I was saying at the beginning. You know, we're sharing faith with a generation that's very different than all of our, no matter, we're probably different generations here too, but they learn in different ways. And so we can't just rely on reading the book. That is boring to them, but there are so many ways to engage them, to invite their participation. You only learn when you're participating. You only remember when you're participating. Thank you. Okay, one more. Anybody else want to share with theirs? Okay.
Number six, the question is, how many of these learners for so little time that you can't really be done? He actually teaches third grade, and my wife's a great teacher, but she actually has like a little lesson plan ahead of time. She puts in a timer for that first 10 minutes, do an open, activity, 5 minutes of prayer, 20 minutes lesson plan. It kind of feels like as we're growing, we get so much done. I think you can get overwhelmed with time. We have an hour and 15 minutes, it's really a mess, but you think an hour and 15 minutes, it seems to be and also, if you engage them, like they were saying, it really doesn't matter what time. You feel like they got some out of it, whether it's 30 minutes or an hour and 15 minutes, I think you're going to really give you something. And be realistic about your expectations, too. Don't go in thinking, I got to teach them all this, and they don't want this day. You know, just trust me, they're getting something out of it as long as you keep them engaged. It doesn't matter the time.
Great points. I've worked with candidates, too, who think, you know, they'll even look at their book and say, but it doesn't cover this, but it doesn't teach the rosary, but it doesn't do this. How am I going to get all that in? But this is similar to what you're saying. You don't have to. I mean, it's good for candidates to look at the scope and sequence of all 8 years or 12 years. That, yeah, I'm not covering this, but somebody else is before me or after me. Because there is no way we can cover everything. And in fact, I would keep saying to them too, because I think we did something wrong years ago. We get frustrated, especially those of us in adult information, we're frustrated because adults aren't coming. But you know what? I think we're reaping the benefits of what we said a long time ago. A long time ago, we said to families, if the children come, and we said to the kids, if you come for 8 years or 12 years, you've got it all. And so no wonder we don't have adults coming today. And so I think we've got to say to them from the very beginning, you know what? Our faith is so rich. There is so much more to discover about God. And it never ends, you know? So maybe we keep saying that starting now when they're kindergartners. Maybe then we will have lifelong learners in the faith. Right. Mm-hmm. Great. Good. Very good. Okay. So it's 3 o'clock. I don't want to keep you from your right before your next session. There's a lot of other, there's a lot of other ideas and situations there that I'm sure you've encountered. So feel free to, you know, engage one another as your own parishes to talk to other catechists. As our Bishop Gregory said this morning, we need to talk about our joys and also our disappointments, because we